there's simultaneously more and less going on here than you might be guessing. But before I explain, a quick recap of what Project CompuSAR even is. I'm building clones of classic 8-bit computers, such as the Apple II and the Commodore 64, on cheap-ish FPGA. Unfortunately, this requires me to build a lot of the components from scratch. Oh, am I kidding? That's actually the fun part. Anyway, one of the ways to reduce hardware requirements, and therefore cost, is by shifting some of the tasks from hardware to software. This means that the CompuSAR computer is actually two computers running in parallel. One is the 8-bit computer we're trying to be compatible with, and the other is a 32-bit RISC-V to handle translating modern hardware interfaces to the interfaces the 8-bit side of things expects. Which brings us to the display adapter. This computer has two of those, one for the 8-bit computer and one for the 32-bit one. I mean, eventually we'll have only one's actually done. Now, I don't have a lot of leeway regarding how the 8-bit display works. Its capabilities are pretty much defined by what the original computer could do. So for the Apple II, that means we need text mode in 40 n80 columns mode, low and double low res graphics, as well as high and double high res graphics. Do anything else, and the programs I try to run won't work. The 32-bit graphics adapter, however, is open for me to implement in whatever way I decide. It's a brand new computer, and I'm not bound by any legacy whatsoever. Which brings up a perhaps obvious question. Why even have one? If the purpose of the RISC-V is to handle hardware adaptation, why would it even need a graphics adapter? One might expect the display to, most of the time, just show the 8-bit computer's output. While there is some truth to that question, there are cases where we will want the 32-bit computer to affect the display. These fall into two categories. The first is for direct interaction with the user. Think configuring the device or loading a system update. These require a full-screen interaction while only the 32-bit computer is running. The other case is for status indicators. These might be indicating that a drive is being accessed, a status bar, or if you happen to be the creator of the system and would like to show off, maybe a watermark. There's also a third thing I'd like to have, which is a hybrid of the first two. I would like to have a debugger for the 8-bit computer. This will freeze the 8-bit computer's execution and allow inspecting and modifying memory, registers, and such. In this mode, the 32-bit computer needs a whole screen while also showing the 8-bit screen. One obvious way to do this is to have a 32-bit per pixel display. This uses 8 bits per each one of red, green, and blue, and have an additional 8 bits for an alpha channel. This controls the transparency of the pixel. This is a fairly standard mode called RGBA. And while this mode does indeed solve all of our use cases, it also poses a few challenges of its own. The least of those is that performing 8-bit alpha pixel merging is not trivial. Not horrible, mind you, but would require some work and some logic. Had that been the only problem, however, I might have done it. A more serious problem is the memory requirement. We'll initially be running the screen at HDMI mode 1, which is 640 over 480 pixels. At 4 bytes per pixel, that adds up to over 1 megabyte of memory just to hold the rarely used 32-bit frame. Now, our computer has 256 megabytes, and our mission is implementing computers that were, back when they were introduced, very proud to have 64 kilobytes. So we do have the memory to spare. What we may not have, however, is the memory bandwidth. We need to fetch a megabyte of data 60 times a second, while also fetching the 8-bit computer's graphic data and allowing both computers, plus any hardware that does DMA, to run at the same time. That is a serious load for a computer with a back-end bus of 75 megahertz. And there's one more thing to consider. While 1 megabyte is not more than the amount of main memory we have, it is way more than the amount of static memory we have inside the FPGA, which means it's definitely more than the amount of cache we have. Fetching that much memory at this bandwidth will pretty much guarantee that all memory accesses by everyone will be cache misses. Above all else, however, the problem with this approach is that it's just not needed. We're building a clone of 8-bit computers. Displaying anything in true color fidelity will just feel out of place. A design language based on few colors will simply work better. What I opted to go for instead is having 1 byte per pixel. This means that red and blue get 2 bits each, with green getting 3. There is also 1 bit that indicates this is a semi-transparent pixel. Of course, we also need a way to have fully transparent pixels. We do those by special casing a color. In particular, if the semi-transparent bit is set and the pixel has a red and blue values of 0 and a green value of 1. This color is almost indistinguishable from transparent black, so we're unlikely to miss it. Now, at 1 byte per pixel, the full display takes over 300 kilobytes of memory, which is still more than the amount of cache we have. Looking at our use cases, however, we see that we rarely need the whole display while the 8-bit computer is running. So our display allows the software to define not only where in memory the pixels are fetched from, but also how wide and high it is, as well as where on screen it needs to be displayed. So the image you're seeing on screen now is never moved in memory. The code just waits for a vertical sync and then updates the display screen coordinates to move it. It's kind of like a sprite if you only had one and you could not display anything else at the same time. For most use cases, that means we can drastically limit the amount of memory we actually need while still allowing a fairly wide range of colors to be displayed. In fact, this might turn out to be too wide. I might cut this down further to 16 colors using a palette, which will further half the amount of memory we need. We'll see. Every time I presented this solution in the past, I'd invariably get 8-bit purists telling me it wouldn't work. Their argument was that DDR memory is too inconsistent in its latency, which means we may miss our mark supplying the pixels when they're needed. The problem is twofold. On one hand, HDMI in particular, and most display protocols in general, don't have a handshake mechanism. They are fully synchronous in that the sender and receiver agree on a clock, and the pixels are provided using that clock with no ability for either side to halt the other side. Since we're using the 640 over 480 resolution, we're running with a pixel clock of a little over 25 MHz. This means we need to provide the next pixel's RGB values every 39 nanoseconds, no excuses. If the DDR now goes into a refresh cycle and cannot answer requests for 293 nanoseconds, we're out of luck. Before I describe my solution, let me point out something. Refreshes are rare, and refreshes that coincide with cache misses during fetches should be even rarer. This means that even if we indeed miss a few pixels every so often, and notice that a few here are just a little over 7 pixels, that is probably a small price to pay compared to the huge advantage, which is price, and also price. It's a small price to pay to get a good never mind. Hardware projects are governed by something called the Bill of Materials, often referred to as BOM. This is the price for the producer of the hardware for the various hardware components. The retail price is often dictated to a very large degree by the project's Bill of Materials. Here's the thing. There exists memory that does not require a refresh. It's called static RAM. The Commander X16, for example, uses such memory for its main memory. The Alliance Memory AS6C4008 SRAM. Each chip retails for around €5. This price is for a single unit and for through-hole components. I'm sure the X16 project bought them at a better price, and they're planning on switching to surface mount components, which would make things even cheaper. Compared to the €3 our DDR chip retails for, this does not seem to be a huge price difference. Except there are a couple of important differences between our €3 DDR and the Alliance's SRAM. First, each chip the X16 uses has 512 kilobyte or half a megabyte. Each DDR chip has 256 megabyte. They are 500 times bigger in capacity. Now, that claim can reasonably be countered by pointing out that a retro computer project does not need such a capacity. The other difference, however, is not so easy to dismiss. The Alliance memory chip has an access time of 55 nanoseconds. That means the absolute fastest clock it can support is 18 megahertz. On the surface, that seems quite fast enough for supporting an 8 megahertz W65CO2S, which is what the X16 is sporting. And while that's true, it misses an important point. We're not talking about using the memory for running a CPU. We're talking about using it to store a frame buffer. As I've mentioned before, HDMI mode 1 needs a new pixel, which is potentially 24-bit, or 3 bytes, on a 25 megahertz clock. The memory is simply too slow to have a frame buffer in. I should point out that there are also pseudo SRAM chips, which are DRAM chips with an embedded controller that makes them behave as if they are SRAMs. From my research, they too don't scale up very high in frequency. If you want fast access, you pretty much need DRAM. To me, the only feasible way to go is to go cheap and fast, even if it means occasionally missing a few pixels. One standard solution to this problem is to place the memory from which we read the display, aka the frame buffer, in latency-free memory that is big enough. This is essentially what modern GPUs do. I take multiple issues with this approach. First, this introduces latency in the display, since we're constructing the whole frame in memory before sending it out. We're displaying the information to the user when it's at least one frame behind when the original computer generated it. My bigger concern, however, is more rigid. I just don't have enough static RAM to hold a complete frame. I'm generating the HDMI direct from memory, both because I think it's a better solution, but also because I don't have any choice. Now, technically, you could claim that my memory is the frame buffer, but I'm going to claim that the way I'm composing the final display on the fly from different sources counts as no frame buffer. Sue me. With that said, I don't think it'll ever even get to dropping pixels. I'm using a design that should make such cases exceedingly rare, if not eliminate them altogether. The secret here is a concept called a pipeline. Here's the path our RISC-V display goes from data in memory to pixels on screen. First, a block of memory is fetched. We're fetching 128 bits, that's 16 bytes, in one operation. That's just how big a cache line is, so it makes sense. If the DRAM is going to cause problems, that's the stage where that will happen. Then we convert it from 1 byte to 25 bits per pixel. This includes 24 bits of color information and 1 for marking transparency. At first, I converted them 1 pixel at a time over multiple cycles, but then I realized that the byte selection mechanism was taking up more FPGA resources than just converting the whole thing at once. So at this point, we've converted our 128 bits into 400. Kinda insane. Next, we go through something called clock domain crossing, or CDC. Since the CPU works at 75 MHz and the HDMI works at 25 MHz, we need some logic to safely convert between the two clock domains. We then place the pixels in another buffer until it's their turn to be displayed. What this means is that we have a processing pipeline that holds around 96 pixels when saturated. Even better, since the memory works at a clock that is 3 times faster than the pixel clock, and we fetch 16 pixels at a time, we're filling the memory up 50 times faster than the display is draining it. In other words, most of the time, the pipeline will be saturated. This means that even if the DDR now inconveniently goes into a refresh cycle and is unavailable for 292 nanoseconds, we have enough pixel information to continue the display before the memory comes back online. A pipeline draining to the point we need to drop pixels will simply not happen. On a personal note, it's a nice change of pace to do a video where the video production takes me less time than the development took. The display component is one of the biggest components in the whole computer, at least of those I built from scratch. This, without even counting the actual HDMI encoder, which I've taken from an open source project on GitHub. Hoping the next step will be as exciting. Thank you for watching.